my moments of fear, through every pain and every tear, there's a God. He's been faithful to me. Times my strength was almost gone, and my heart had no song, but still in love, He was faithful to me. Every word that He promised is true. What I thought was impossible, I've watched my God do. He's been faithful, faithful to me. Looking back, His love and mercy I see. Though in my heart times I faltered and failed to believe, yet He was faithful, faithful to me. Looked away. Many times I could not pray. Still, my God, He was faithful to me. Some days I spent so foolishly looking out for what pleased me, but even then, God was faithful to me. Every time I would kneel before Him, He was there with open arms, and I'd see Him once again.
Lord, I want to thank You that You're faithful. I thank You for Your faithful and steadfast love that never ceases. I thank You, Lord God, that You're omniscient. You all know it. You know everything that each one of Your sheep is going through. We bless Your holy name. We thank You, Lord God, that You're a covenant-keeping God. That You said in Isaiah 43 and verse 2, when Thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned. We bless Your name, Lord God.
Hi,
Hi, this is Minister Pat Holmes coming to you live once again from the secret place. And again, want to just remind you that you are blessed and highly favored of the Lord. He has paid for each one of us with his blood. And in that blood is deliverance power. Oh, glory to God. In that blood is breakthrough power. He told us to ask and we shall receive. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door shall be open unto you. Those are the covenant promises of the God that we serve. Well, I'm back to share part three of the series that I began, and the subject was parasites and parasitic seed. And I'm going to zoom in on some more things tonight. I just want to remind you that we're dealing with the prophetic arena. The word prophecy, it has this meaning, to foretell. And the Lord, by His Holy Spirit, will foretell things, and He will reveal those things to us. Not only just those that are in the office of the prophet, for the Bible says nothing will be done on this earth except the Lord reveal it first to His prophets. But I want you to know that the spirit of prophecy moves through and dwells inside of us all, because the Holy Ghost dwells inside of us, and He will reveal the hidden things unto us. The Bible teaches us through prophecy that in the last days, we're in the last days, that God will pour out His Spirit upon all flesh, and that includes you and that includes me. So I'm going to share some things that I have seen the Holy Ghost do and reveal through the years. I want to deal with, in particular, those that are intercessors, prayer warriors, prayer partners, glory to God, those that have began to move forth in the deliverance ministry, because we have to have sight. We have to have His eye salve rubbed upon our eyes to open our eyes, to allow us to see in the realm of the spirit, and to begin to interpret what is being shown us in the realm of the spirit, then to apply that here in the natural. I was thinking about the prophet Jeremiah. Most of you will remember him. And when the Lord called him, one of the first things the Lord would tell Jeremiah, "Jeremiah, what do you see?" And there's emphasis on that. What do you see? And all of you will remember, I'm just going to throw out four things here if you want to go and read that and confirm what I'm saying. If you look at Jeremiah chapter 1, the first book of Jeremiah, "What seest thou?" I believe that's how it's worded in the King James. And one of the times you remember he saw an almond rod. And that almond rod, that was one of the first trees, fruit-producing trees that would come forth, the almond. So as he took notice of the almond rod, and he answered God when God said, "What do you see?" And he told him the almond rod. And God began to release a word telling him the timing that this event would happen, and it would be during the time that that almond tree would bud. Oh, glory to God. I want you to know that this is one of the ways that He will speak. He will show you things with your natural eyes, and then begin to give you an interpretation. And those are some of the things I want to develop tonight, sharing some of my own personal testimonies and sharing some things just in the Word of God. Now, I want to say this up front, because there are those that, you know, last week I dealt with the spirit of the wild. I dealt with patterns and prints and how they can act as tracking devices and homing devices concerning the realm of the spirit. Now, I want to say this. The Bible plainly teaches us in the New Testament, all things are lawful unto me. In other words, you can do anything that you want to do. You can dress in anything that you want to dress in. But the Apostle Paul let this be made known. All things are lawful. It's lawful to do it. He says, "But all things do not edify." It is not edifying for those in spiritual warfare, those are that are positioned on the battleground. He said, "Does not edify." And then he said this, "I will not be brought under the power of any." He lets us know in that scripture, matter of fact, it's in the New Testament twice, there are things that, yeah, it's lawful to do it here on this earth, but there is a power associated with it. One of the things that we can learn from natural warfare
from our soldiers, most of you will remember Desert Storm. And you remember in Desert Storm, our soldiers were required to take on a whole type of outerwear. Their uniform was a sandy looking uniform, similar to what I have here on the screen. This is a picture of it that I have on the screen. It was a sandy colored uniform. They didn't go over there in the green fatigues, because there in that desert, in that sandy area, the green fatigues would make them stand out like bright lights flashing out there in the desert. So they had to dress in order to not to blend in with their surrounding. So all of this plays a part. Again, we're taking some principles in the natural, and we're taking them in the realm of the spirit, and we're developing them, glory to God, to equip us and weaponize us, the soldiers of God. Another time God spoke to Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 13, asking Jeremiah, "What do you see?" And he said, "I see a marred girdle." Now, the girdle was that belt that they wore around their waist, and it tied all of those loose garments together back in the days of old, the Jewish attire. So he said, "What do you see?" So he saw a marred girdle, and the Lord began to speak to him about that marred girdle and began to compare it to his chosen people. Again, God will show you natural things and release a prophetic word with it. And then you remember in Jeremiah 19, there was the broken jar. God began to release a word concerning his chosen people, concerning that broken jar. I remember this personal testimony. I guess I'm jumping into my testimonies a little bit early, but how he would show you things in the natural. I was at a friend's house many years ago, and I shared this testimony in my book. I've only released one book, and it's out. But I shared this testimony, and it was way back in the day when we would do decoupage. Some of you women will remember that. And I guess I never did decoupage because I don't know how to do it. But you'd cut out a picture, and with some kind of special glue, you could put it on your cookie jars and whatever you wanted to decorate, metal cans or whatever, and a special glue, and you'd seal it in there, and it was your own design. So I'm sitting at this friend's kitchen table. Now, I remind you, this is a woman of God. This is a woman that served on the altar in ministry. She loved God. But as I said last week, we can have spots, wrinkles, and blemishes, strongholds on the inside that we have not dealt with. So she wanted me to see her new decoupage canisters that she had displayed. So I'm at the table, and I looked over there on the counter, and I went, "Oh yeah, they're really nice." And I really couldn't see them well, but from what I could see, you know, it's really nice. Well, she, I don't know if it was her in particular wanted me to see, the Spirit of the Lord was guiding her, because this would wound up being a situation for deliverance. So she came over to me, and she put that cookie jar right in my face. And when she put it right in my face where I could see, there were like the Everglades that are there in Florida, the Florida Everglades, these big, tall, beautiful green leaves. And hiding behind the Everglades picture on this cookie jar was a serpent hiding behind. And I just went, "Oh, brother." Because I knew then the Lord was getting ready to reveal something. And sure enough, he did. I began to pray about what I was seeing. And he gave me a dream just a few nights later. And in this dream concerning her, I saw a bedroom with four posts, those tall posts that are on each end of the bed. And on one of those posts, I saw red lingerie hanging. And I knew some kind of way it was associated with her and some bondage in her life. That's all I knew. Because to see her in the natural, she was the most modestly dressed woman I had ever been around. She was a soft-spoken woman. She was a woman, as I said, that went forth in ministry on the altar. She had a beautiful personality. Everything. You can have all of that going for you and still have junk hiding on the inside. So I shared with her what had been shown me in a dream. And she said, "Oh, yes. When I was a little girl, I would go over to my aunt's house." My aunt was I think they called it in the old days, an old maid. I can't something. There was another word. an old maid. The aunt had never been married. The aunt had a hope chest. You remember in the days of old, and maybe now the women believe in God for a mate. They would have a hope chest, and they would put all the things that they would use and have when that groom came. And so the aunt had lingerie piled up in that hope chest, where she would go there when she'd visit her aunt. She would dress up in the lingerie. Now you see, that was just something you think, just a little kid game, nothing to it, but a spirit got attached to that. First of all, a child shouldn't be dressing up in lingerie. The child didn't know what she was doing, but the spirits that acted as home and devices knew exactly what they were doing. And sure enough, she began to tell me the story later, how she would begin to slip out of the window as a very young teenager, like 13 years old, going to sleep with different boys in the community and slipping back in the window. And it got worse and worse. She was showering one day. I may have told this a couple of weeks ago. And something knocked her down in her shower. She knew it was the presence of a spirit. There are spirits that are called incubus and succubus. The succubus spirits come to have sexual relationships with the men, and the incubus spirits come to have sexual relationships with the women. So she was going through some of all of that, and I think I did mention it, but it all started with me looking at a picture on a cookie jar where a snake, I'm going to be dealing with Pharaoh, and remember that cobra that he had on his crown, I'm going to be dealing tonight also with Beelzebub or Beelzebub, the Lord of the flies. I'm going to deal with those two spirits tonight and some things that the Lord has shown me. You'll also remember concerning Jeremiah, that one time in Jeremiah 24, the Lord asked him, Jeremiah, what do you see? And it was two baskets of figs. And God began to develop a prophetic word, release what was getting ready to happen to Israel. Those that had a heart for the Lord, and that basket, the Lord say they were the good ones, the ones that he would say. Those that were operating in evil, oh my God, they were the ones that would be destroyed. But it simply started with asking Jeremiah a question, what do you see? So I want to say that tonight, what do you see? I'm reminded right now of he calls himself a watchman. Most of us call him a prophet. What a powerful, holy man of God. He went home to be with the Lord, I guess about 5 or 6 years ago, and that was Pastor David Wilkerson. Some of you have read his books. Oh my God, you're talking about a man that was given prophetic vision. But I heard some ministers sharing when they were in his presence some years ago. This was a man that was in a relationship with God, and they were there in New York, and he took them on top of a building many years ago, and he asked them, what do you see? And they were like looking at the man of God, and they were younger ministers and they didn't know. And they told how Pastor David, his voice raised up a little bit. What do you see? He knew it was very important to see with prophetic vision, to be able to see in the natural and allow the Holy Ghost to tell you what was going on. So finally he explained to them as they were on top of that building to take note to all of the businesses that were now coming up in New York that were from foreign nations, and how the foreign nations were invading our nation, and how the businesses were spreading all over. And he began to develop that. And of course, we see now what's going on in our nation. So again, what do you see? I want to pull up first Pharaoh, a picture of Pharaoh. We're very familiar with this image, and we know that Pharaoh thought he was a god. Let me pull this one up, and you can read that yourself. I'm not going to read it, but you can go back and read it later. Let me get it really big. So we see on Pharaoh's head is a cobra snake, the image of a cobra snake. And we all remember the story when Moses went there, and we remember the showdown, do we not? And Moses's rod, showing that the rod of God, the authority of God, will destroy any serpent serpentine activity. Glory to God. But nevertheless, this snake, symbolic of the fact that he was being ruled and reigned by the power, the leadership of Satan. And God had to bring a showdown. Glory to God. I'm going to call it the showdown down in Egypt. And the bottom part is information concerning that last plague. All of us remember the 10 plagues that occurred down in Egypt. But the last one was the death of the firstborn, which really shocked Pharaoh because he thought he himself was a god, but he found out who the real God was. So I just wanted to bring that out, that image that's on his head, that cobra. He was operating also under the power, being influenced by Satan. You know, all those miracles that Moses did, you knew he was influenced by Satan because he was so stubborn and he wouldn't give up. I mean, my God, I would have given up on the first one. The snake God was eating up. But he didn't give up because the enemy is a stubborn, persistent devil full of evil, and he does not give up. So I wanted to bring that out because I'm going to share some things and try to stick with my notes dealing with when the Lord has used the image of the serpent to reveal some things to me. The next thing we're going to deal with, I think I'll do better just pulling up the images and then I'll remember what I have going on here. I'm going to deal with the snake tonight, and I'm also going to deal with, this is an image of the fly god, Beelzebub. We all remember that. Beelzebub, Lord of the Flies. And I wanted to tell you this was one of the gods that was down in Egypt that the Egyptians would worship. But God's people were there, so God's people began to get entangled with all of that foolishness also, just like these days. We're here in a land. We're mixed in with people with all type of belief, and God's people are being entangled with some of this wrong thinking. And here, the fly god, I just wanted to bring out at the very top of this graphic here, the fly god, let me see, it says of creation. Okay, he was the Egyptian god of creation, really? And then it goes on to say he was the one over the movement of the sun. He was the one over rebirth. Can you believe that? The fly god. And there they were worshiping that fly god. But not only that, God's people had been down there, mingled in and mixed in for so long that they began to forget who Jehovah God was. And so it is now. People that grew up in church, grew up learning about the true and holy and only God and his son Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Ghost, they are now worshiping other gods. They have gotten confused and they don't know what they believe. They just have a contaminated mixture. Oh my God. But God is removing through teaching the spots and the wrinkles. I don't know what's on this next one, but I'm just going to bring it up. Oh, okay. We're going to read some scriptures here. We're going to deal with some things that are going on because I'm going to try to get off of here quickly tonight. So I'm just going to power punch some things that are going on in the land. But God tells us in Leviticus 19 and 28, it says, do not cut your bodies for the dead. And it says, and do not mark your skin with tattoos. I am the Lord. Where tattoos right now, they're all over the place. They're all in the church, if you remember. And I'm going to show your scripture in a moment because there are some that go, that's Old Testament. Well, I'm going to show you that when God brought forth the new covenant, he told Jeremiah that the old would pass away and he was going to make a new. But there were things brought over into that new covenant that were in the old covenant. I'm going to show you that. Even the commandments themselves, 9 of the 10 commandments can be found over in the New Testament. The one that cannot be found, the one that didn't get transferred over into the New Testament, was the one concerning the Sabbath day. Selah. Pause and think about it. So he tells us not to get tattoos. And then here now again, he's talking to the priests. This is in the Old Testament, but I bring this up because in the New Testament, in the book of Revelation, it is said that we are priests and kings. So if we want to learn some things concerning the priests and what is expected of the priests, we need to go back and read and allow the Holy Ghost to download it for us and give us understanding. So then he deals with baldness in Leviticus 21 and 5, talking to the priests, thou shalt not make bald patches on their head. They shall not make bald patches on their head. Now, we know that there's natural baldness. I'm not dealing with that. We know there is sickness that calls baldness. But have you noticed how baldness has really began to be on display? Women are shaving their heads. It's the new end thing. Oh my God. I remember Dr. Rebecca Brown, who I mentioned last week, and I showed you her book, and I'm planning to show a book or two by her tonight, as well as another author. But she brought out how when we follow demonic fads, see, Hollywood, New York, wherever all the models are, and those that are supposed to be in the fashion industry, they will always introduce something that's new. But the child of God is not to walk to the drumbeat of what Hollywood says is it. There are a lot of demonic fads that can get you in trouble and cause you to trespass and transgress and then bring even a curse upon yourself. When we trespass concerning the things of God. I'm trying to go down to verse 6 real quick. What does it say? It says, they shall, oh, this is good. Talking to the priests, it applies to us, God's modern day priests. They shall be holy to their God and not profane the name of their God. That word profane means to make common. Some of us so try to make him so common, like he is the boy next door that we high-five and keep by our side. Oh my God, he is a holy God and he is to be honored and reverenced. Glory to God. He said himself that I am a great God. He was telling that to his people in the book of Habakkuk. I am a great God. He was talking to his chosen people because they had forgotten. And he said, even the heathen fear me. And here you are, you're supposed to be my people, but you have no reverential fear of me or my word. Oh my God. But he says again, and to the priest said, thou shalt be holy, they shall be holy to their God and not profane the name of their God. It says, for they offer the Lord food offerings, the bread of their God. And it says, therefore, they shall be holy. So he's sharing the office that the priest is in. The office deals with the bread of the Lord, which is the word of the Lord. And the Lord is saying, I have chosen you. He's chosen us all, whether we're standing on an altar preaching or wherever we are. If you're a child of the Lord, you have been called to present his bread, present it in your lifestyle, present it in your conversation, the bread, the word of God. There should be his attributes reflected inside of us and through us. So he tells us right there that he is a holy God. Oh, glory to God. Now I want to deal with, show you a picture many of you are familiar with. We were dealing with tattoos, and I want you to know there's a spirit behind it. Some of you remember this man. I don't know his name. Didn't have time to look it up, but I remember him from way back because they had featured him in a story way back. He continued to tattoo, and you see what he turned himself into. And after a while, he committed suicide, because the same devil that will influence you to tap into these demonic fads is the same devil that will confuse you and cause you to end your life. Oh my God. But he tattooed himself up until that is the image. Oh my God. The whole image speaks of death, does it not? His whole image there, it speaks of death. Let me see, can I find my little red dots and get him off the screen? It's just so sad. That's somebody's child. But when the enemy comes in, he comes to kill, to steal, and destroy. This is why we cannot go with every demonic fad. Just because we see it in a magazine or we see our friend has engaged in it, oh my God. Now, I want to say this. We must have the power of the Holy Ghost dwelling inside of us in order to resist the devil. The Bible said, resist the devil and he will flee. And I want to add, I tell my Bible study this all the time. Back as a teenager, had those tattoos been popular when I was a kid or a young person and I had the money, I probably would have joined in with the in crowd because I did not have the power of the Holy Ghost indwelling me. So you follow what your friends say is in fashion. But oh my God, mothers and daddies and relatives, let's teach our children and lay hands on our children that they will be empowered with the Holy Ghost. Now I want to say this because this is a true thing concerning most ministers' kids. The enemy will come after them, it seems like double time, and drag them out to get involved in the same thing that you have preached to them not to get involved in. A lot of preachers are out there saying amen. And the reason the enemy does that, it is to shut our mouth. But you know what? The devil is a liar. God said for me to open my mouth, and he said he will fill it. So I don't care in the sense. I do care about people being drugged out into bondage by the enemy. But I am not going to allow it to stop what thus says the Lord in my life. Glory to God. And I pray that you are in agreement. Speak up. I remember one time years ago, this mother had this daughter. You know, they'll get in rebellion a lot of time when they begin to turn a teenage year. And she told her mama, who was serving God, well, mama, you used to do it. And I remember the mama calling me and said, well, she's right. Maybe I need to be quiet because she's right. But the mama was now serving God. I said, don't let her use that against you. You represent Jesus and you let her know that. You are now serving Jesus. You now know the better way. You now know his way. And don't let her seal your mouth, because the devil will use anybody, normally those in your own bloodline, to try to shut your mouth. But again, the devil is a liar and he is the father of all lies. Remember that. Let me refer to my most already dealt with Beelzebub. Oh, I want to share this because I just heard this a few nights ago. This was so interesting. I have a Beelzebub fly story. And I heard one by a woman of God last night. She's a prophetess of the Lord, and she was at a Chuck Pierce meeting. And thank you, Norma, for sending me that video. So anyway, she began to share about going over to Nigeria. And when she was in Nigeria, she ministered her ministry. She brought money, and she and her ministry, they bought computers for one of the schools. So anyway, before she left, one of the chiefs there in Nigeria wanted to speak to her, one of the tribal chiefs. So she came over and he said, you need to move over here, because her ministry was bringing such an influence. And he said, I want to give you some land. And she said, give me some land. He said, yes. So anyway, he gave her 5 acres of land and he said, you build your house on it so that you can come over here. He wanted that ministry there to teach the people. So she accepted and she was thankful. So before she left, she got a call from another tribal chief, and she went there to meet him, her and a ministry team. And he said, I want to give you some land also. And he was giving her 25 acres of land free of charge, paid for. She had signed the paperwork with the first chief and had gotten those, I think it was 5 acres. So anyway, she said when she walked on this land, she was standing under this tree, and when she looked up, this tree had a swarm of flies flying around it. As she observed that tree, the Spirit of the Lord said to her, no, do not take his gift. This represents Beelzebub, Lord of the fly. And there was some demonic activity associated with that man and his operation. And the Lord told her no. So she told the chief, I thank you for what you offered me, but no, I have to refuse your gift. He said, but it's 25 acres. She said, yes, sir, I'm turning it down. See, God but gave her, just like he did that with Jeremiah, with her natural vision, seeing a swarm of flies, the Spirit of the Lord speaking what spirit was associated with that gift. That's why we can't even receive every gift. Sometimes there is a power operating behind it. Sometimes there is a motive operating behind it. We have to be in tune with God. We're dealing right now with Beelzebub. I showed you the image a minute ago. Lord of the flies. He thinks he's Lord of creation, if you remember when I put that up. And he also, and also that he causes the sun to move. Oh my God. The devil is so deceived. But his job, he's trying to deceive each one of us. And of course the devil knows he's not any of that. But if he deceives us, then he wins the victory, does he not? But I wanted to share my own personal testimony years ago. We all, a bunch of us women, went up to a wonderful conference that was held in another state, and I had just gotten my SUV. Now, so that was some years ago. My SUV is old now, but it's still going, the glory of God. So anyway, I asked a particular friend of mine to drive everybody up there, take my vehicle and drive it up there, drive all the women up to the conference. And I flew in that afternoon, or maybe the next morning, I think it was. But when I got there, somebody met me, and there had began some turmoil between the women. Oh my God, and just a little bit that I heard. So I was like, let me just go to the room, because I think we had two or three rooms there. So when I opened the door to that room, and I could see the faces, the expression on the faces, some of them were still fussing. It was so sad, because it was just the enemy. Beelzebub would stir you up and get you angry over nothing. And this is what was going on. One or two had gotten upset because this woman was driving my vehicle, and one of them, anyway, I won't go into all the details. It started over the driving of my vehicle, and all these people have now looked at this situation and seen that it was the work of the enemy. So when I opened that door, God's honest truth, this big fly came right by my head. And you know those big ones, how they make a noise and they just irritate you. So I really didn't catch on the first time the Lord was showing me, but when it came back maybe the second or third time and I began to zoom in on what I was seeing with my natural eyes, he let me know this was the work of Beelzebub, the Lord of flies, and that I was to take authority over that and speak peace in the midst of that situation. He will use natural things to give you insight of the devil's invasion. Oh, I'm telling you, the devil takes air out to. I have a friend that says this. I love it. Brother Mike, he says this. The devil will never miss an opportunity to be the devil. But we should never miss an opportunity to be a warrior on the battlefield for Jesus. Oh, glory to God. So anyway, that's my fly story. Beelzebub, Lord of the flies. I want to say this, because I want to build hope. I don't want to just build doom and gloom and oh my God. No, we are warriors and we have the power of the blood of Jesus. But do you remember Peter when he was asleep in the New Testament on top of that house, and the Lord let that sheet down? You remember that? He let that sheet down in a vision, and that sheet was filled with all type of unclean things and wild beasts, because this is what I'm dealing with, the nature of the wild beast. And when we allow that to invade us, Peter later called it brute beast, and we don't want his nature influencing us in any way. But anyway, the Lord told Peter to rise, kill, and eat. And Peter in the vision went, oh no, Lord, I've never eaten anything unclean. And the Lord let it be known, do not call unclean that I have cleaned. Now we know that the Lord was getting ready to send Peter to the Gentiles. They were considered unclean. And tonight, if you're not a Jew that's listening to me, you would fall under the category of a Gentile. And we were considered unclean people that would do anything, practice anything, participate in anything. But the gospel came to us, the unclean. So I want to throw that in to let you know, no matter what you've been engaged in, or relatives have been engaged in, or I myself myself was engaged in the power of the Holy Ghost, the authority of the Word of God, and the blood of Jesus will cleanse and deliver us and wash away every spot and every blemish. Even with this teaching, God is getting His bride ready to stand by His side. Oh, glory to God. As I move on down, I shared about that prophetess. I'm just going to share some testimonies here. Testimony of the woman God. Okay, I shared that one. Let me see what I got here next. Another fly story, how the Lord used the fly in the natural fly. This lady just kept insisting that I come out. This was years ago. Come out to have lunch with her. And her mind was really scrambled of what she was seeing. Y'all, some people want to be around you because they think they can you can position them somewhere, or you know somebody and you can get the door open for them. That is the wrong attitude. We are servants of God. He is the one that is to be exalted. You remember when John the Baptist said, I decrease so that He can increase. But anyway, she had her motives all mixed up, and I knew that. But finally, I went on and went and had lunch with her. And oh my God, in this nice restaurant, all of a sudden this fly come and he begins to circle her head. Now, I didn't really notice the fly at first, because flies, they'll come where there's food. We know that. But the way the Lord allowed that fly to circle and continue to circle, and it was loud, one of those loud ones that you want to just hit with your fist. But he began to teach me right then that her mind was fly blown. I found out later that she literally was mentally disturbed, but she was trying to seek the things of God. So I just prayed over her. I haven't seen her after that. But he will do that. He will use something natural. I'm talking tonight to those who are asking God to apply the Isaiah, or who have already applied the Isaiah. I'm just sharing some things, some of the ways that the Holy Ghost will reveal things, prophetic things. Glory to God. I already dealt with the tattoos, and let me see what I have him. The serpent is called the most subtle beast of all. I have that on my paper. I want to read you the scripture. You're very familiar with it. Genesis 3 and verse 1. I'm just going to read a portion of it. It says, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. He was more subtle. And the word subtle means crafty, sly, sensible, prudent. And you know, the Bible calls him wise, and he is. He strategizes against us every day. Every day by faith, he lays a trap, hoping that he can entrap us. But every day by faith, we should be armored up, glory to God, and asking God to cause us to see and weaponize us where we can destroy the plots, the wow, the plans, the attacks of the enemy. Glory to God. As I go down, I'm almost through. I'm on the last page. I only had two pages, and I'm halfway through the last page right here. I'm trying to see what else. I know I have a couple of other, let me see, items of clothing. I wanted to bring out even item of clothing. I think I mentioned this last week, but there are things that can cause a certain mindset and also can attract spirits, certain clothing items that can attract spirits. And I brought out Desert Storm already, I think, but how clothing is so important. And a lot of times when you teach the things that I'm teaching, people will say, you're a clothesline preacher. You just want to preach out of our closets. No, I'm preaching how the enemy can have a legal right to come and attack and come and attach himself to you. And this is why, even in the Old Testament, if you remember, there are so many principles that are learned in the Old Testament. God told the people that they were not to mix wool and linen together in their garment. Now, that sounds so petty, does it not? Do not mix wool and linen. I'm not saying we're under that now, but God was establishing a principle back then. I don't have all of the revelation on that, but I do know, the wool, symbolic of the Lamb of God, who would take away the curse concerning us. And we know that the linen is symbolic of the robe that we will wear when we make it to heaven. We'll be given white linen robe that represent righteousness. So the Lord would not have righteousness and also the curse dwelling all together. Glory to God. I want to say Selah, pause and think about it. You know, those like, she's just a clothesline preacher. Where God, he was interested in clothing. He told those priests, do not come up on my altar without your undergarments on. And those undergarments came all the way down to their knees. And God specifically talked about nakedness on the altar. Oh my God. Think about it, if Jesus said in one of our church service today. Well, I want to say he is there and he sees everything. I want to pull up my next graphic. I'm not sure what it is, but we're just going to flow with whatever it is. Oh, I'd mentioned earlier that I would mention this, because one of the things that we hear a lot, the Old Testament is done away with. And Jesus, the curse was taken care of on the cross. I want to bring out that in the Old Testament concerning the law, there's the civil law. You see that at the top. We still have civil laws in our land that started back then, the civil law. Somebody steal your cow in the Old Testament, you could go before the elders and they handled the civil law. And then there was the, I can't even read my own writing, the moral law. We still have moral laws. God expects us to live decent, holy, separated life. So there was the moral law. And these things still exist. But also in the Old Testament, there was the religious, a ceremonial law. And as you read that, Jesus took care that, nailed that to the old rugged cross, the religious and ceremonial laws, where they had to bring a goat to get forgiveness for that, or bring a cow to get forgiveness for that, bring a turtle dove to get forgiveness for that. Jesus nailed all of that to the cross, fulfilled that. That was used, he said, as a schoolmaster in the days of old. It was teaching the people, establishing boundaries around the people. But we still have civil law and we still have the moral law. Glory to God. But Jesus again nailed to the cross those religious and ceremonial laws. And as I said, we can still find 9 of the 10 commandments in the New Testament. So all of these people with the mindset, just throw the Old Testament away, you'll never learn the likes and the dislikes of God. It was there he said that in the last days, which is where we are, that some would call holy things unholy and vice versa. They would call clean things unclean and vice versa. In other words, it'd be all mixed up in their mind. That's exactly where we are. And concerning his people, this passage is coming to me now. You remember in the book, I believe it was Jeremiah also, God was so grieved with his chosen people. We are the chosen people now, those of us that accepted Jesus as Savior and Lord. And he said, the sea has boundaries around it. He said how the sea will go so far that way, and then the waters will come right back, because there are boundaries around that sea. He said, but my people, they don't have any boundaries. They've let all boundaries go. And that is exactly what this modern day greasy grace teaching is teaching a lot of people. Let all boundaries go. You're not under that no more. The recent thing that was in Christendom concerning we don't have to pay tithes. The devil is a liar. I was teaching my Bible study right from the Word of God, how tithes first got established under Melchizedek. If you remember when Abraham brought tithes to Melchizedek, first time, the high priest. And then when the law came, tithes were brought to Moses. But the Bible says in Hebrews, I believe it's chapter 5, that God brought another priest, his name was Jesus, after the order of Melchizedek, the first priest. And it goes on to say in that scripture, had the Levitical priesthood perfected us, he would have never had to bring forth the high priest named Jesus. And he specifically said he came after the order of Melchizedek. And Melchizedek received tithes. It also teaches us in the New Testament, Jesus was talking to the people and he complimented them for tithing. And he said, these things you ought to do. So don't let this greasy grace teaching teach you that you are not to pay tithes. We are to be liberal givers. Advance from our tithes and move to giving even more. I remember that old song, it is no secret what God can do. What God has done for others, he'll do for you. When you tithe and you obey God, God will bless in abundance. Glory to God. Well, I'm not on tithing, but I wanted to just throw that in. We're dealing with the parasites. And I wanted to show you this. I covered her face because last week I dealt with the spirit of the wow. And I told you last week when I talked to Daniel Yoder, Dr. Rebecca Brown's husband, and I showed him my chart years ago, he picked up on it right away, and that he shared with me. I shared it with you last week. But it has long represented being a sexual image. And not only does this woman have on all of her spots, but she has her serpent shoes to go with it. Oh my God, I can tell you a situation about some serpent shoes in a church. Well, I think I'll just go on and tell it. This guy that was playing the piano, gifted, and I think he's delivered now from what I can tell, but he was young at the time. But I didn't really notice it. A friend of mine noticed. She was like, look at that look in his eyes. And he was just a young teenager. When I looked, it was this stealthy look, just all black, and it was like the eyes weren't even moving. And it reminded me of a guy that we'd cast the devil out years ago, how God had showed him in a dream and compared him to this snake. He literally compared him as a snake in the dream. And anyway, we had to deal with him, get him set free. But anyway, when I looked at this guy and I saw those eyes, oh my God, I jumped. I went, she's exactly right. So I happened to look down at the floor and he had on shoes very similar to hers. They were snake, and he had like a size 11 or 12 foot. So it looked like a literal snake on his foot and going up. Well, come to find out, because the situation happened right after that where he got in trouble with the law. Oh my God. And anyway, I won't go into all that. He got in trouble with the law. So I was talking to somebody that knew him well, even from school, and they had said how they had put him on psych meds years ago. And see, even the word, you know, when we deal with the word pharmacy, our word pharmacy, dealing with medication, psych meds, and all of that, and it's where the word pharmakia in the Greek, and it means sorcery. And there are meds you can get on to control your mind, and you're under the power of the enemy, where he operates through you and he controls you. And that's exactly, I could share some more on that, but I'm going to leave that alone. Because as I'm sharing these testimonies, these are people of God. These are people that love God. And as I said earlier, through the power of the word, God is a deliverer. I have three things here I want to share, and I'm going to close it out. I want to mention, oh, I got her books too, Dr. Rebecca Brown. And let me just hold up this book. This one is so powerful. If you don't have it, it's called Unbroken Curses, Dr. Rebecca Brown. Unbroken Curses. Even though Jesus nailed it to the cross, the curse of the Mosaic law, nailed it to the cross. Things were nailed to the cross. But when we go and trespass and transgress, we can bring curses up on us. Oh my God. As well as the judgments of the Lord. This is another book by Dr. Rebecca. I mentioned it last week, and it is called Prepare for War. Dr. Rebecca Brown, Prepare for War. She shares a whole lot in this book on prepare for war. All type of demonic things we can get into. She shared in one book, I wanted to share it. Now, I don't think she shared this in a book. She shared this with me personally, she was having a meeting, and there was a young girl in the meeting, and the power of the Holy Ghost was in the meeting. This girl began to manifest. So Rebecca says she jumped off stage, and she saw the girl was dressed in all black. You know, this gothic stuff some people get into, and it's all symbolic of being under the umbrella of that same snake that was on Pharaoh's head. And she began to manifest, and all type of stuff was going out, and the devil threw her out and whole nine yards. So she was in all this black. So Rebecca hollered out in the meeting, "Anybody have any fingernail polish remover?" They began doing deliverance on her right now. She had on all of this black nail polish. Rebecca said, "I began taking that polish off right there in that meeting," because as she began to remove stuff out of her that gave the devil off of her, that gave the devil a legal right to be attached to her, then her deliverance was able to come forward. But she dealt with literal black nail polish. I could tell you a story on that, but I don't have time. And then dealing again with the snake. I remember one time walking into a meeting that I was over. I was the leader at this particular group. And as I walked in, I noticed a lady just leaned over, and all I could see really was her back, and her head was all the way down in her lap. But she was dressed in full serpent attire. The blouse was a serpent pattern. And oh my God, when I looked over there, I went, "Oh Lord, this is going to be something here that have to be dealt with." And sure enough, she was going through some stuff with the teenage son, and it was a mess, and a girl he impregnated and all of that. But anyway, it had brought her just under a spirit of great oppression. She was leaned over. She could barely lift her head up. And by her being dressed in the serpentine fabric, the Lord was letting me know how the enemy had invaded her mind, invaded her peace. So anyway, got a chance to work with her, glory to God, and she came out on top. Let me see what I got here. Another one I wanted. Oh, yeah, this was a leader. But anyway, God gave me a detailed dream one night. He does that, a detail for that particular situation. He will give you, as you operate in the prophetic realm, the prophetic flow as a child of God, when he begins to move the scales off your eyes and allow you to see. And it is for the purpose of gain, of praying, and helping getting captive set free, and also for preserving you on the battlefield, letting you know what you're dealing with. So anyway, I had this dream, and I saw the man of God and the woman of God in bed, and I saw her dressed in full leopard from head to toe. And the Lord just began to speak to me concerning the sexual bondage in the marriage. It was out of order. There are several more things I could share on that where it was confirmed and verified. I'm not telling this just to deal with that, because we all have to check ourselves in every area, but I'm telling you how the Holy Ghost operates. So he showed me that night, and like within, I think, 24 hours or less in the natural, I'm out of the dream now, there's the woman of God in an Afghan, I think that's how you say Afghan, fully leopard from head to toe. The Lord had just shown me that in the dream. And oh my God, later on, he began to give me in one night, seven dreams back to back to back concerning the man of God. Man of God, love God. But I'm trying to share tonight, we can love God with all of our heart and still have areas in there that need to be surrendered and cleansed out before the Lord. And I was told to go and talk to the man of God, and I went, "No, Lord, give that assignment to somebody else," because I admired this man with all of my heart. And the man could preach. Oh, glory to God. But I had to obey God. So we went, and my husband and I at that time, we went. And we went in and we shared, and I shared everything I'd seen, Do, Re, Mi, 1 through 7. And he looked at me and said, "Oh no, Sister Pat, oh no." And God had revealed how he was out of order sexually. God had revealed that there were other women in his life. Now in the natural, I saw none of that. And I was around that man a whole lot. I saw none of that. Nothing that reflected that at all. But yet, here in this dream. We're talking about the prophetic arena. God revealed what was going on in secret. Oh, no, oh, no. And me at the time, I was really sort of a baby Christian. I went, well, if I missed it, if the devil has influenced me in some way, I need you to pray for me, because I just want to be led by God, and please pray for me. And I came home, and look at God. He comes in another dream. Go back. Oh my God, please. So we go back. So this time I stood outside the office door of the man of God, and I allowed my husband at that time to go in and talk to the man of God. And the man of God bowed his head and said, everything Sister Pat shared is true. It was God that showed her that. And I talked to him later, and I said, you know, come by. We'll pray for you. Nobody has to know what's what. This will be done in secret. And he said to me on the phone, oh, no, I don't want anybody to know. And I can't even tell the rest of that story. I'm going to leave that right there. I just want you to know that God will reveal the secret things. Why are you sharing this, Minister Pat? For the purpose of us getting before God and say, God, cleanse me. We all know what spots and blemishes are on the inside. We all know what unclean things we are attracted to. I remember sharing this years ago with the group I was over. This is so cute. So anyway, I dealt with pornographic books and all of that type of stuff that people have hiding. So this man of God that heard me share this, he came back to me the next Sunday. He said, Sister Pat, and he was looking down. He went, when I got home, I went out to, it was like a well house. I went out a pump house or something, and I got all those books I had out there, and I burned them. He had all type of pornographic books. But this, I shared that day, I'll never forget. I said, God is getting ready to turn on a searchlight. God is going to turn on a bright light, and God will reveal. And he will, because he said, warning comes before destruction. So I'm dealing with the spirit of the wild. I want to recommend this book right before I pray also. This is so good. This is by Bob Larson. It's called Larson's Book of Spiritual Warfare. And the reason I so love this book, he has done it like an encyclopedia for you teachers and ministers, whatever subject that you need to know about. Like, he has one here called The Black Mass, M-A-S-S. And it's just full of subjects. The Church of Satan, he gives information. He went to Africa and he sat in on one of those voodoo rituals and recorded how they beat the drums forever, and then how the spirits come in, and then they can walk on fire. And it's done in other nations also. But I love that book. It is a powerful resource to have on your in your library. Any subject you need to look up, telepathy and oh my God, there are so many. Yoga. He has a whole chapter on yoga, even how a doctor yoga also, no, but the other deal on what is it when they put the pins all in you, acupuncture, that is done a lot. Oh my God, it's legal, but it will invite spirits on the inside. And there was a Chinese doctor in this book that his business practice was with acupuncture, but when he heard the word of God and God began to give him revelation of the spirits associated with acupuncture, he closed down his whole shop. He had been doing acupuncture on his wife for many years, according to the story Pastor Brother Barb Larson wrote in that book. And she hadn't gotten healed from the acupuncture. But when she gave her heart to the Lord and repented, then all of those symptoms left her body. We're talking about the spirit realm. We're talking about parasites, parasitic seed. We're talking about giving the devil a legal right to invade. And I close again with that scripture again. Paul said, all things are lawful, so you can do what you want to do. But he said, all things are not expedient. They do not edify the kingdom of God. And he said, I will not be brought under the power of any. Father, I thank you for the teaching of this word. And I thank you that you are weaponizing us, Lord God, your soldier, that you're removing spots and wrinkles. You're freeing us up because the battle is getting ready to get hotter. And Lord, you don't want us out on the battlefield and just overtaken because the enemy recognized that we're packing some of his junk. We're talking about Satan. When he has a legal right to come and take us captive, oh my God. Lord, you're trying to clean us up and gird us up in your armor. And I thank you for the teaching of this word tonight. I thank you, Holy Ghost, that you're downloading it to each one, and you will add even more revelation as you prepare the bride to stand by his side. In Jesus' name, we pray this night. This is Minister Pat Holmes trying to find my little button here. Yeah. And I am signing off again from the secret place. Shalom, which means peace.